Tonight, we're going to dive into the world of cryptocurrencies and where it's headed in the future. Why are people still buying Bitcoin after huge price drops? And will Swiss banks one day open up their doors to crypto companies? Now, here to shed more light on this issue is Niklas Nikolajsen, co-CEO and chairman of Bitcoin Suisse. You've been embedded in this scene for nearly a decade now, and I'm sure you know the industry like the back of your hand. But I want to start with you, first of all. When you go to family events and they ask you what you do for a living, how do you put it into plain, simple words?
Well, I guess I'm the equivalent of a bank director, but in the crypto asset space. So I tell them that I take good care of people's assets and their money, and I expose it to what is called crypto assets or Bitcoin.
You're actually a Bitcoin multi-millionaire. And I just want to know, is being rich in Bitcoins the same as being rich in dollars or francs?
I think wealth can be many things. Dollars is one denomination, but even if you are dealing with a wealthy dollar millionaire or billionaire or whatever, you'd find that most of his assets are tied up in real estate, in companies and stocks, bonds and so forth. So, I mean, it's not very normal that somebody has $1 billion just sitting in a big green sack.
What's really interesting is that you actually said in an interview once that there is only one type of crypto investor, someone who regrets not buying more in the first place. Can you still say the same given the market climate now?
Well, it's a frame I like to use when the market are moving up and you are in all-time high territory, because clearly right now, in this particular moment in time, there are two kinds of crypto investors, those that wish they bought more, and I'm one of those, and those that wish they didn't buy in December.
You seem to have so much trust in cryptocurrencies, but you're actually a little bit biased, I would say, since you made so much of your wealth off of it. How do you maintain this trust when it is so volatile?
I think when you have gone through the market so many years as I have, I mean, there's nothing extraordinary in a large correction like the one that took place in the beginning of this year. I've seen many such corrections, perhaps as many as 10, and some much more violent than the one we currently had. And I guess you get, let's say, insensitive and confirmed when year after year your assets are performing generally very well.
But Niklas, I think some people at home, they're not such big risk takers as you. They might see all these shifts and swings and get afraid of getting into cryptocurrencies.
But that's certainly also a valid argument. I would never advise anybody to put their entire 401k into something that is essentially a high-risk asset. And since we are in an adaption phase of crypto assets and Bitcoin in general, they should be treated as a high-risk asset and only make up a minority of your portfolio.
Do you feel like sometimes we're engaged in this wild goose chase? One day it's 12K, one day it's 7K. Do you get some thrill out of all this volatility?
Well, I do operate a brokerage, and certainly as a trader, volatility is not necessarily a bad thing. But I think we can all agree for some long-term general adaption of crypto assets as a means of payment and a store of value, you will probably need this volatility to decline. But that will come as the market grows and as you have the same financial instruments available as in other markets.
So you're certainly not shying away from risk?
No, I am certainly
like
a very risk-averse, risk-affinite person for sure.
With so much money sitting in your account, you obviously also have a lot of investment options at hand. So give us a little bit of advice. Where are you putting all this crypto wealth into?
Well, I have a fairly diversified portfolio, but at the end of the day, more than 60, maybe even 70% of what I own is directly exposed to crypto assets.
Are you investing into anything unusual or peculiar?
There's a lot happening this year in the space. I call it the Kryptonian explosion. It is simply we see the definition of the future protocols in the decentralized space being created. Many of these will fail, but some will certainly also triumph, and I do invest in those projects.
Since you have so much experience in this field, which sectors or industries do you think you've faced the most obstacles or aversion to?
Well, there's, I guess, particularly two fields of human endeavor that are slightly skeptical or, let's say, do not fully understand and maybe also fear what the decentralized consensus revolution is bringing along. And that would be the traditional financial industry, to a large extent, and to a smaller extent, governments and jurisdictions all over the world.
You've actually been quite critical of Swiss banks in the past of not opening their doors and creating accounts for crypto companies. Can you actually give me an example of where you walked into the bank, asked them to create an account, and they just said, no, we're not going to offer that service?
Well, I can probably give you like 53 examples in Switzerland.
A memorable one.
Well, certainly when our company got going in 2013, there were no issue. But then Bitcoin became quote-unquote famous, and all of a sudden it was realized in the banking industry that you had this internet money and that it was perhaps unregulated. And then you would receive, or we received letters from every single banking relationship we had saying, please remove your money, close your accounts. And that was, of course, sad for a great number of months. Even my personal bank account was closed down and I had to go and pay everything in my life in cash.
Okay, but is it for the company or the fund that you put it into, the cash?
When I spoke about before, I said they closed both the banking relationships of the company, Bitcoin Suisse, that I was starting, but certainly also my private accounts. So I had only cash available.
So not only the company, but it went into your personal assets as well.
But I can, to some extent, understand the traditional banking industry, because you're dealing with a small new market, and it doesn't always make sense to invest the effort in understanding it when it is a small market. And small markets typically also attract, let's say, a lot of the not most professional actors.
You sound actually quite sympathetic towards the banking industry. Does that mean that if you were working in that sector, you would be doing the same thing, taking the same approach?
I think over the years that I've worked in the crypto financial space, I have matured a little bit. Had you caught me 3 or 4 years ago, I would be an insulted child in the non-engagement of the banks. But now, with Bitcoin Suisse also progressing towards becoming a regulated entity, I certainly understand the challenges they face a lot more.
You just told me earlier that you like taking risks. So why would you not be embracing this if you were from the banking side?
Well, I am personally a happy adventurer and risk taker. But if you are running a large public company, as most banks are, then you are directly responsible to the shareholders. And certainly you shouldn't, in the financial industry, as a company, be a risk taker. If you do that, then you're gambling with other people's money, and that's highly immoral. And in most cases in the financial industry, also illegal.
So from the spectrum of banks in Switzerland that are slowly opening up to the idea of cryptocurrencies, is it the smaller banks? Is it the bigger banks?
No, I think when you are dealing with new business areas growing up, like in the crypto scene, you will see the smaller actors, the more flexible actors moving first. It is only what one could expect, that the smaller banks who need to profile themselves or differentiate themselves to the bigger retail banks are the first movers. And that's
so
also what we're
example,
seeing.
For example, which banks?
That would be in Switzerland and Liechtenstein. It's the smaller private banks that have moved first in this scene.
Can you give us some names?
Well, that would be, in Liechtenstein, I would say it's Bank Frick is the leading actor. In Switzerland, certainly the first bank moving in this space was Falcon Private Bank, and later on Swissquote, and now a number of other banks are also getting started.
But the end goal is to catch the big fish, the big banks, right?
And I think that that will naturally happen over time, as not only the technology matures, but also as the market grows and as the financial industry instruments become available in the market, but certainly also when there's regulatory certainty. So when you can engage as a big bank without risking your entire business on what is basically
a
new
venture.
But what
is the big hesitation? Is it really the fact that they don't have the know your customer aspect to it, or is it potential issues of money laundering? What is their real fear?
There's a lot of fear. First of all, you wouldn't be pushing a financial product to your client as a big reputable bank that has maybe a shorter track record as many crypto assets have. Because if your client get burned, then you will probably be made to answer for it. But certainly also, most crypto assets don't, from the technology side, carry any information about the identity of the holder. And this leaves many people to be worried that it could be potentially a tool for money laundering.
But aren't they actually pricing out a lot of the wealthier customers who are already clients but then come to them and say, hey, I have a lot of crypto wealth, isn't that, aren't they ignoring that large sector then?
They are ignoring it less and less. Only a few days ago, another Zurich-based bank let it be known to everybody that they would be happy to accept wealth originating from crypto. And I think in 5 years' time, that's going to be absolutely as normal as if you have your wealth from any other field of business.
Is this a disruptive business?
It is redefining a lot of things. It's redefining how we store assets and how we issue assets and also how we do settlements. In the long, long term, it could affect the way that that we organize our societies. I don't think you can underplay the decentralized blockchain, quote-unquote, revolution in any sense. The changes are going to be major. But it is going to take, like with any large change, many years before we realize the full impact.
When you walked into meeting rooms 5 years ago in Switzerland, how were people talking about cryptocurrencies compared to today?
Well, the fast answer is they weren't.
But you were.
I were. I worked at a large Swiss bank when 5 years ago in Switzerland, and I was actually trying to promote the topic within the bank. When I saw that that was probably not going to work, was when I started Bitcoin Suisse as a separate venture. The first few years, every time you met a lawyer, every time you met a banking relationship and you mentioned the word Bitcoin or crypto asset or Ethereum, they would just be big question marks.
They were skeptical, right?
Well, first they were blissfully ignorant, but after that came also some skepticism. But I think that's completely changed today. I mean, today Bitcoin, for example, is a means of payment even for public services in Switzerland and for setting up companies, and just about everybody, including the tax authority and the financial regulators, are quite deep into this theme.
Do you almost feel like you proved some doubters, early doubters, wrong by this stage?
Well, I think we can say with some certainty that that I did, didn't I?
You know, talking about all this cryptocurrency hype, was it really just a distrust of regulated equity markets or fear of missing out?
New technology in general captures the public imagination much more than many other things does, and so does the topic of money. And what you're dealing here with is a new money technology, so it's actually in the power of two to what can capture public imagination.
It's also the prospects of getting rich.
Certainly.
We can't ignore that.
No, certainly there's, and there is in any market, a certain amount of greed, also good greed and certainly also bad greed that is in play. That's clear.
How will we be talking about cryptocurrencies in the future, Switzerland?
Well, in the far future, we won't really be talking about it any differently than we have been talking about, I guess, other major asset classes and even sovereign currencies. And I think even these fields are going to merge at some point where even sovereign currencies themselves will at least partly be issued on the blockchain as a means of distribution and settlement. And I think we will be talking about it in the same way where you talk about other big mind-blowing innovations in your life, like plastic, or like the rubber tire. You don't talk about them because they're just a natural thing, a part of your life.
Speaking of being a part of everyday life, since you're such an advocate, you must surely have some bitcoins on you.
Bitcoin isn't cash per se. Bitcoin is data, mm-hmm. Data that only one person can own. But you can, just like you can print a computer picture, you can also bring the data into a physical representation. And I carry my lucky Bitcoin here from 2011. It's a 25 Bitcoin coin. They used to retail back in the day for around $50. And a coin like that today is around $200,000.
You can whip that out at your next family meeting when they ask what you do.
I think I've whipped it out countless times already at family meetings and other venues.
Just make sure it's tucked away. Thank you very much, Niklas.
Thank you very much, Olivia.